So let's look at the contents first. So it goes like introduction, timeline, forms and rationales for private participation in PPPs, implications of private participation in PPP modes, insights from the field, and then emerging issues. So before proceeding further towards the studies and what they say about it, I just want to brief about what actually the nature of school education and why it is really important, because Government of India clearly defines what higher education is a type of a good and what school education is a type of a good. And yesterday we also heard from Pranjan sir about merit good in terms of water. So we know what merit good is, but the thing is, in the context of school education, it becomes important because on the basis of categorization of merit good, lot many countries have actually made a rationale for the support of state for providing education. And merit good actually conceptualizes as a private good for and whose consumption needs to be promoted, and consumer or people cannot be relied upon because they might not have the correct information to value the actual benefits of education. So you cannot actually rely on the on parents how they would value education. For that matter, state really has to enter in and has to make the provision for the education. So this has been a very important, one has to really keep that thing in mind. Why school education falls under the purview of merit good when we are really talking about categorizing education in different categories of good. So, and actually Tilak has also mentioned that in fact in many countries provision of making elementary education compulsory and free is based on this rationale. Since as Emondi mentioned that since our focus was the period 1991, and it is actually a very important phase for India because economic reforms actually initiated and World Bank entered with the structural adjustment policies, and which actually changed the nature of provisioning and financing of school education. So at that time, there were a lot of international programs which were launched in World Bank, international donor agencies started influencing the environment of the school education, and there was a lot of progress which was made in terms of school education. The schooling options in terms of types of schools and enrollment and access, there were a lot of improvement made in these parameters. However, there were considerable challenges which still persisted, like people belonging to different disadvantaged categories were still not enrolled, and even girls were dropping out after primary education. So they could not even complete the basic elementary education as well. And then there were a lot of criticism relating to the teacher activity, what is actually happening in the school, particularly pertaining to the government schools. There were a lot of criticism which was taking place to focus that government schools are not functioning at that moment. So this was the kind of changes which were taking place at that period of time. So on one more thing, when we are looking into the literature of PPPs but in education, we have to see that a lot of literature comes from the private sector in terms of a lot of focus is on the comparison made between private schooling and a government schooling. It does not per se talks about PPPs. So it's a broader discourse of privatization in which the debate surrounding education is actually instilled. So to just start off the discussion, I'm just giving you a brief statistics about the share of different types of management. And when I say management in India, there are actually two types of management. So by management, there are two types of schools which are getting run in school education. One is by the government, that are called as public schools. Another is the private, which are actually further categorized into private aided and unaided. And aided in terms of that government gives lot of support in terms of running those schools, in terms of teachers' salaries and expenditures are being taken care by the government. And in terms of unaided, everything rests with the private sector and they manage. And very interesting thing is, over the basically from 2000, there has been a rapid surge in private unrecognized schooling. And within unrecognized unaided schools, there are two types of schools. one is recognized and other is unrecognized school. And unrecognized schools are generally termed, and there is a lot of international evidences on low fee private school or low cost private school. And Ball to Nambisan and Tule, they have done a lot of focus on, they have actually done a network analysis of that, which actually brings forth about how big that sector is and how actually they are working at a level which we, as ma'am was mentioning, that we can't even think of. And there is so a lot of studies are actually on low fee private schools to realize that how vital they are for students and for meeting the needs of education at the current times. So this table actually shows that actually if we take the scale of 1990, then the growth rate would actually be much more. I have still taken the latest years of 6 years. Even then, the government share have actually fallen quite considerably. It is actually comes out to be 13.42%, and the private sector has actually jumped to almost 22%, and within that, unaided sector has actually jumped to 29.62%. So that is a major share, and one has to keep in mind that government data does not take into account the unrecognized schools. Recently DICE has started taking the information on unrecognized, but it's very amusing to see that in Delhi there are zero unrecognized schools. They have listed zero. So it can never happen like that. Actually, I studied LFPs during my MPhil dissertation. So there were plenty of low-fee private schools when you go outside just your house. So they are running in small shelters. So you find so many of them. So when they say there are zero schools in the data, it's very, you really think about how come they are not able to find the thing about it. So that is, but there are people who have studied this, say almost 40 million people are actually enrolled in those unrecognized schools. So that's a quite a big number, which generally don't get any value in these things. So then, similarly, when we look at the enrollment, even in the enrollment case, that students are actually moving towards unaided sector. So this is also very dangerous kind of a shift which is happening, that it also gives a to say that government schools are actually failing. So this is one thing. And now if we see the participation of disadvantaged category in the schooling sector. So the thing is, these are the first column is, first two columns tells us what percentage of disadvantaged category students are enrolled at the moment at elementary level, and out of that, how many of them are enrolled in government and private sector. And when we see that actually private sector is not catering to them, it is only the government sector who is the sole provider to them. And
they wouldn't know what scheduled class and scheduled tribe is, so you might just need to explain that very briefly. Do you want me to do it?
Yeah.
So under the constitution in India, first of all, the constitution of India has a contradiction. Caste is outlawed by the constitution in India. However, there's a schedule within
untouchability
is outlawed. But there is a schedule in the constitution which protects scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. Tribes being the original inhabitants of India, and scheduled caste being the untouchables. So they have reservations in certain jobs and certain higher education, for example. But they don't have reservations at school level. However, there's an expectation that schools will obviously cater to them. And the evidence is that scheduled caste and scheduled tribes are catered for by the government, and they don't really get access to the private sector.
So basically government caters to them. It's not the private sector who is actually looking into the demands of those disadvantaged category. And within disadvantage, they have actually expanded the purview of that category, which also involved the economic category at the current times, which calls an economically weaker section. So which that category varies from state to state, which is dependent upon the kind of poverty scale is at that time prevalent in every state, basically what kind of income, average income a person is earning. And if a person income falls below that threshold level, that person comes under the economically weaker section category. And they can avail lots of benefits under the RTE, that is Right to Information Act 2009. So which we'll see, because that is also one of the PPP kind which people are saying. So how this kind of inequalities or malpractices which are actually happening in that area. So I just sorry for not mentioning, DICE is actually District Information System for Education, who collects information about school education, and that is elementary and secondary education both. You will find all sorts of data relating to school, starting from number of schools, types of school, enrollment, and there are some indicators also relating to quality on which they actually get the data. So we are not going into the authenticity of the data, but there are issues about that. But that,
I just want to ask a clarification. Yeah. Just in terms of this urban data, it's like barely 50% cumulative of government and private. So does that mean that 50% children are not enrolled?
Yeah, there would be many. So,
the urban SC plus ST is coming back.
40% are going to government
schools.
No, because
that is a separate thing altogether.
So 45.
So these are percentages which are just urban.
No, I think, but as I was mentioning that we are not going to, really claim the authenticity of data.
I'm not looking at authenticity. I'm just asking.
Where are the other 50%? That's what you're asking. Where are the other 50%
that we have to really look into?
The total is the 100%, which is include ST, ST, and general.
But here it is ST, ST is 90%.
So the thing is that we really have to see, but this is the pattern. So not true that 90% children in rural are meaning SC ST. No, 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 no dropping out or what is happening or where they are
school children in urban locations where a large number of options.
Are you kind of questioning the reliability of the data itself?
So I can't comment about the reliability, but this is how the data is presented in the dice. So these are the set of figures.
50% is too large for that. I mean, irrespective of the authenticity.
Some of them will be in the private, some of them might have dropped out.
I mean, the number is quite huge, that's why. That's
does this include the private management? Includes what?
All sorts of private management.
All private management?
Yeah.
As defined by DICE?
Yeah, as defined. It's
so
completely from the DICE.
Unrecognized falls totally outside.
So
they might have some of them might be unrecognized. But 50, I agree with Amita that 50% is too large a number for elementary school. Even if you said another 10% were in unrecognized.
This is the percentage. No, it's not the total percentage. It's a percentage of the total enrollments, isn't it?
But you can't have one logic for rural.
No,
one
I'm saying
it's
urban. But it is percentage of SCST. So this is percentage of SCST is to total enrollment.
Yeah, total enrollment. The ones who are at the moment. Eligible.
I mean, out of the 100% of SCST, 50% are enrolled in government. I mean, 40% are enrolled in government and 5.75% are enrolled in private, and therefore more than 50% are not enrolled at all, according to this data.
Yeah, according to
that will be too big a number.
That's what I'm saying. That's what
Amita was saying. The question is where is it? But they are not accounted for in the data.
That's what in fact I was trying to say, that how authentic this data itself is.
But DICE is supposed to be one of the most authentic data systems.
So Madhura was saying, for example, 84% government plus private in rural, also as a question considering the migration pattern.
No, that's a very minor thing.
So authenticity is a question.
Talking about 84% children.
We are
50% children are out.
They're not talking about.
And in rural areas, it's not that high either.
Correct.
I mean, you would still see a total number of SC around 20-25% at the maximum.
No, that's, this is the total percentage of SC students.
So total enrollment,
right?
It's within SC/ST.
No, it's not within.
Yes, it is within
SC/ST.
It is within.
It is
the nature of things that it is. Look at the nature of percentage. Otherwise, it would be different. Anyway, sorry.
No, it's fine. Because since you have also raised it, I will also look more in fun. So that is not now.
Is there any indication of the gender composition?
There is a composition of gender as well, but there are different tables which I'm not. I'm just
so one could identify, despite the limitations, out that 50%.
Yes.
So there are ways to actually corroborate that information and see how authentic.
And why do you think, I know we don't know, but what would account for this 50%? Is it for data collection? Is it a political, is there any indication what's behind them?
So that's another story altogether, how data comes there and...
But I think we need to know that in the literature.
There are lesser private schools in rural areas. And most of the enrollments would be in the government schools. In the urban areas, there is a high proliferation of low-fee private schools which are unrecognized and which might go unnoticed and not accounted for in the DICE data.
Okay. I just think, like, in terms of the literature, given that they're for a wide audience, I think that's a really kind of interesting point. And I think it needs to be included, some discussion of what.
Now, if the question is that SCST are accessing low-fee private schools in urban areas, then that's a really interesting point. Because my experience in rural areas, I've got a field site in Pune and a field site in Rajasthan. In both cases, the government schools have 90% enrollment of SCST.
Yes.
And none of them, every OBCs, everyone else is going into low-fee private. And none of the SCST get access to low-fee private. So if they're accessing low-fee private in urban areas, that in itself is an interesting story, if that's the case.
You know, there are actually, if we look at the LFP literature, most of the literature are concentrated in the urban areas. Whereas low-fee private schools, they are actually because...
Yes, but are they opening their doors to SCST? That's what the question is.
So that is
a
different...
That's the question.
And then the question of affordability comes in.
Affordability is the issue.
So,
Because that's... Anyway, can we pack it
go? So given the scenario of that there is a rapid rise in the private schooling as noticed by lots of literature, and given the inequalities in terms of access, participation and quality and functioning of particularly government schools, from 2000 particularly, their government of India is actually promoting or moving towards the mode of partnerships in order to elevate the problems relating to public education particularly. So that is the move, and why I'm saying about the year 2000. Because it was at that time in 2000, the government came with the first policy document, that is a subgroup on PPPs in education. That was in the year 2000. And there was explicit mention of PPPs as a mode of delivering education. So that is why that year has to be really taken care of. And in general, if we see that in current times, partnerships are considered as an innovative measures of financing, which brings the finance from the private sector, would actually help since government does not have the resources. So, and it is the best way to draw the best of the public and the private sector. Literature also says like that it's an approach which balances too much of a state at one side and too little of private. So it mixes up both of them, and it's a third way out of actually delivering education. So, In the rebalancing of public and private finance, various forms of partnerships are becoming very common towards delivering public services. So, in this, since I mentioned that from 2000, there was an explicit mention of PPPs as a mode of delivery, but however, literature has found, and since I read the documents, there has been a repetitive assertion that PPPs is not a kind of a mode which was not prevalent in Indian education. In fact, partnerships have been the way of life for India. But we really have to think that what sort of partnerships were used to exist earlier and how those modes are different from the current modes which are actually envisaged in the new policy documents. So that we have to remember. So studies have actually looked at that during post national policy of education and when the plan of action was launched till district primary education program launched. So at that time the focus of education or the problems of education were quite different, and at that time actually partnerships were actually started off where NGOs were given recognition to help government to reach out to the people, disadvantaged people, SC, STs and the hilly areas where it was difficult to actually bring into the formalized system. So the key was they will bring into the formal system. So those were the partnerships, and NGOs were the partners at that time. And similarly, but when DPEP came, and that was the time actually structural adjustment policy also came in, and World Bank played a very important role. And there were a lot of international development agencies and voluntary education. And what was the shift? Actually, informal systems were given recognition as partners, and they were asked to actually support government to eradicate the issues relating to quality of schooling. And at that time, government schools were the focus in terms of they were criticized about there is no actually teaching activity happening in the school in the classroom, and teachers were not performing. And by performing, they mean that they don't teach in the classroom. They don't take care of students. So that was the focus at that time, and it has been cited in these literatures. So, and now I come to the main focus of 2000, that was the period of legitimizing PPPs actually. So how actually it also carried out the work done by the DPEP. They proceeded further with the district primary education program, since the words which were used in for reforming the school education were same, ensuring efficiency and effectiveness in the education delivery, but they became much more explicit in those documents. So how do they actually legitimize? By actually defining PPPs. It was in the 12th plan, that is 2012 to 2017, that is the planning year, in which the government defined PPPs for the first time in school education. Of course, that was adopted from some foreign international organizations who are working on PPPs, and they actually defined PPPs as a cooperative venture between the public and the private sector, built on the expertise of each partner, that best meets clearly defined public needs through appropriate allocation of risk, rewards and resources. This was the designation actually coined for the PPPs. And then they actually come up with the models. I would not say that they clearly defined it, but they proposed these are the models, and there are some examples of these models which you actually find in the current times. Yeah. So and they laid very clear cut expectations from the private sector, that private sector would come in and it would be a very good relaxation. So and what was another thing, there was an explicit mention of corporates, that corporates would be true partners in resolving issues of public education. So if we see the earlier partners, there was no mention of corporate. So it's very interesting how they are relying on the corporate sector, and if we come down to the rationale, the very first rationale is about insufficient budget resources, which is always the case with PPPs, that the government does not have resources, and it has to go back to the structural adjustment policies, the way World Bank influenced its role of actually not allowing government to spend on basic service public utilities. And it said that we have to use public sector expertise, competency and resources to ensure efficiency in resource use and effectiveness in the education delivery. And since there are a lot of criticism relating to government school public system, it was assumed that the private sector would actually correct the public sector inefficiencies. So these are the three core rationales which are actually surround the debate on PPPs. And now we just say why the corporates, and these are the core participants at the moment that you will find in the sector. So the foundations, And the rise of foundation is also interesting because in 2013 government also implemented Company Social Responsibility Act, and after that there has been rise in the donations. And if you see various business reports, education is the only, not the only, but is the sector which has received the maximum donations. Education is the sector where corporates are investing. So this is very interesting. And you see private sector form a foundation and they get money from all the private sector who don't own a private foundation for them. So they pump in money into that foundation. So that is also... So within corporations, these are like for-profit. Foundation would have an entity of non-profit. So they can't make profit. But corporations are like for-profit sector. So there are a lot of companies like Educom, Education Initiatives, who are actually doing evaluations, going into a schooling sector. Lot of mechanism like computer-aided learning and enhancement. So these are the sectors on which they are actually working upon. These are the areas, and then there are NGOs, and in NGOs, the shape of NGOs has also changed a lot. So they were partners. So Disha Navani has done a study on NGOs, so where she actually critiques the new modes of NGOs. So she says that the earlier forms of NGOs were very different, and why they were different, because education was the core objective. It was the principal thing. And that was the only sector in which NGOs were concentrated. But now what we see, the NGOs are doing multiple things. Education is not their first objective. And second, the way of working, it's a very managerialist style of working. They don't view education the way we see education, where teacher, student are involved, but they try to implant the practices in the management sector into the schooling. So the way they perform, the way they treat education is also, the treatment to education is very different. So that is one thing.
I'm sorry, who did you say that study was by?
Disha Navani, 2002. Yeah.
And what about these foundations? Their work in education is also similar?
It's it's different, because since they are also private corporates, so every foundation have a different way of dealing or looking into it. So it's very contextualized.
So you told us Disha's study looks at the role of NGOs in education. So are there studies also of these kind of foundations?
So there are studies which have done on foundation, but they have not particularly looked upon the character of a foundation. In India. So I can't say what they have said. So I can't say what kind of work they are doing or what are the processes they are following, that we need to see. But in NGO, there has been a study which has talked about how the NGOs have changed over time.
I just think that in the foundations category, you must bring in the Coca-Cola Foundation, the Monsanto Foundation, all the major corporations, Medanta, so I think they all have a non-profit arm. I mean, I looked at it for health, but actually their major focus is on education.
Between all of these. So
yes.
Are there network studies?
There is.
Yeah.
There is.
There are network studies.
Some of them, yeah. Even
Namisan has done that.
Even the setting, including the setting up of schools.
Yeah.
So
they all link to our...
Right. But I think the link between the foundations and the NGOs, I've done that for health, and it's very interesting.
It's one of my books. So it's about a decade old. And it actually shows how the profits go back into the West. Which is some of the really interesting stuff. But the foundations and NGOs, that hasn't been done.
You mentioned the NGOs themselves had changed, right? With the Navani study. What you actually find is the way in which these foundations or corporations partner with select NGOs. And it was very revealing for me when I did that for health.
Good to see your study as well, because to sort of see...
Yeah, but this has just gone into publication. This is the most recent. But I can give them the cues. I mean, if you go into those websites, you'll get all the information.
Yeah.
But I think it's very interesting commentary on both sides. The link that you
and also I think the coming together, so yeah. Teach for India has been looked at quite
a bit. That is
it's a PhD study.
Yes, yes. So the coming together of foundations.
Yes.
And so this coming together with of foundations with NGOs for delivery. And financial. You can see the school education program in Bombay Municipal Corporation actually did that.
So these are the private participants at the moment who are actually playing a bigger role in education. And now we look at the PPP modes which are actually being listed in the policy document. This I have taken from the PPP subgroup on school education which came in the 12th five-year plan. That was a document and they have proposed that these are the models which can be actually looked upon in school education. So the very first model is work and service contract, in which actually the everything of provisioning, financing rests with the government sector. But the non-academic activities like midday meals, support services are actually outsourced to the private sector. So that is one set of a model. And then management of existing schools. So in this also the... Actually, there could be variance if when we think about management of existing schools. But what they have said that everything rests with the government, authorities. But the thing is management. By management, it means it could be anything. When we define, when we see management in school education, they could actually say that the teaching, how teachers are governed, could be actually taken, given to the private sector. So their work and services contract could be managed by the private sector, or it could be as we see lot of example in terms of school strengthening program. They are also like an adoption models, but government is actually taking care of everything. But the thing is, they could actually improve the enrollment. There would be different parameters on which private sector would rope in and would be asked to work upon. So there, one could think of many examples under this purview. But government is the main authority. So then this third model of design, build and manage model is like, sorry, I have to see that, it's a bit technical. So under this model, the private sector design, builds and leases the school and manages the facility. Private sector actually designs, builds or leases the school and manages every facility, but government retains the control over the delivery of education. And by delivery it means via teacher recruitment and paying the fees for the students so that access doesn't hamper. So it is an example of aided schools which are actually, there's a long history of aided schools which I have also shown in the data that falls under the purview of private aided, but it's more or less actually financed by the government sector. So that can be categorized under this. I'm giving an example so that it's relatable. So, and then the case 4 is interesting, and it is something which government has high stakes or hopes from that. It's design, build, manage and deliver. So by that, the government actually gives the full autonomy to the private sector. And within this, government gives the land also to the private sector on lease. And that lease could be very funny. The land lease could actually start from rupee 1 to rupee 50. And that could be for the 99 years. So that is very interesting.
So even the private schools are built on the land.
Yeah,
of the
government. Yeah.
This work and services contract, you talked about non-core support, but there's also core teachers.
Mm-hmm. Teachers. Yes.
And that's really critical. Mm-hmm. Because that's creating... It's creating a real schism in the culture of school.
Yes.
So I think it's non-core certainly, mm-hmm. but it's also core.
So actually they start with this justification that this could be the way, mm-hmm. but actually it is teachers who are the main focus. So actually with every model you could actually come up with various variations. There could be a lot of changes. So in the fourth one, so this is the kind of model which is government has actually come up with, model school scheme. there's a lot of policy document, and one has to see that the government has actually taken back that policy initiative as well, because private sector was not interested. There were not much benefits under that, and the locations were actually weaker, areas which were difficult to reach. So they have actually set a term which says that I don't remembering the term. So there is set of areas which are defined for such PPP models. So, but private sector don't want to go to those areas because it's very tough to go there, and various other reasons are there. So they have actually scrapped this policy. But very interestingly, every state has a different policy in this program. If we see Karnataka, Punjab, they are actually implementing this policy on their own behalf. They are actually running up these model schools under different names. So it's very interesting, while at a national level it has been abandoned, but at state level it's still getting implemented. So, and contract school, so this kind of a model could actually be related to our charter schools also. Mm-hmm. In the Western literature, you could actually have a lot of similarities in that. So in terms of contract school, so there could be two possibilities. Like I said that in India, till elementary level of education, there is a free education for all students. So, and within that, there is one clause which says that every private school has to reserve 25% of seats for the students belonging to disadvantaged and economically weaker categories. So they have to reserve it, and government would reimburse them automatically, depending upon how much expenditure. And that's very interesting clause, how they want to reimburse it as well. So there is a different debate about that. But the government would reimburse those students and pay to the school directly. So this is not a voucher. Voucher is something else where the government directly pays to the beneficiaries, and they can avail the school which they want to. Actually, this system was started in some part of India, like Delhi, I think it was started, and Center for Civil Society was a very big player in actually pushing for the vouchers, but it actually didn't, could not take off, so it actually flopped in a while. So, but there have been studies like Mullidharan and all have looked upon vouchers, and they say that it's a very cost effective mechanism of ensuring efficiency and providing quality education to the poor actually. So these are the range, and with every successive model you will see that there has been more responsibilities which have been given to the private sector. So when we study privatization, you will see such tables. So the responsibility moves towards the private sector. So in a way that PPPs are actually a camouflaging, the way literature says, is actually camouflaging various ways of privatization. So now coming to implications of PPPs, what people have said about what PPPs are. So the very first theme actually is about privatization and commercialization, how they view private participation, and when they come in, what will happen. So Krishna Kumar actually said that PPPs are actually more like an ideology. They actually promote privatization, and in a way they reduce the, it actually a way for the government to reduce its responsibility to provide schools, which is actually happening. So if we see the share of showed you that the government schools are actually falling. So it legitimizes to say that yes, government could actually abandon its responsibility of providing education. And similarly, Tilak actually had given a have written about model school scheme. He has come up, there was an article actually in which he viewed model scheme and analyzed the various contours of that scheme. So he said that if we look into the intricacies of the model, it will actually provide no relief to the government, and it would actually mean that a lot of money is actually shifted from the government sector to the private sector, and at the end people would suffer, because there is a provision of that private sector have a liberty to actually choose the students. They can actually, there's a fixed certain percentage which have to be reserved for certain category of student, and beyond that private sector is free to charge any fees and what sort of food is there. They are actually free to do that. So that was the scheme, and he has actually critiqued that scheme, that it will not provide any relief to the government, that private sector would provide any resources or it would be a good way of delivering education. So he says it would only lead to commercialization and privatization of education. Now Navani 2000, which I was mentioning about NGOs, so even Kumar has also talked about those NGOs, corporate NGOs. They have a very distinct perspective about education and its relation with the government. So Namdasan and Ball, I also captured that, how they did that. And Shivastava is actually very interesting. She has studied low-fee private schooling. She is from University of Ottawa. So she has looked her PhD thesis in Lucknow. So recently she has come, I think her paper has come. So she actually talks about that, how low-fee private lobbies are actually using PPPs as a tool to legitimize them. So it's very interesting, and how she has actually done a study. It's a desk study. So, but she actually looks at how Pearson work is happening and how Pearson is playing a very big role in actually legitimizing such schools, and they have a lot of stake in these schools through curriculum and all.
So how is this term evolved as an independent research LFP?
Prachi Shivat, she claims that she has...
where does this low fee come from? Low fee in relation to private schools?
Yes.
Or low fee in relation to the groups that they are catering to?
Private
schools. The context is private schools.
This is the thing, the way that should it be called low fee private schools or low cost private schools?
Yeah. But they are both.
Yeah, no, but that's a debate in that as well, because of who it's referring to.
Affordability.
But yet, they have succeeded in kind of keeping that and making that terminology.
That terminology is now official terminology.
So, ma'am, it's very interesting.
Actually, framed by researcher.
So actually,
but the framing itself gives a position. You know, low fee, then you understand what is high fee, low fee, what is the benchmark, how do you discriminate or include all those issues.
Because low fee doesn't mean that it's actually low cost to the people who are paying.
So I would say that there are different lobbies, but the different groups, and they say different terms. So like, if somebody is promoting, they would say, they will not use low cost or low fee. They will say these are budget schools. categories have been used by different groups.
But none of these groups seem to actually symbolize any subaltern kind of perspective at all.
Because of the history of where this came from.
Yeah.
It starts with the Thule study, but that's a different story. Mm-hmm.
So, coming to the second aspect of implication relating to access to education. So, again, I will like to say that when we looked at the implications of education, so most of the studies fall under the domain of comparing private and public schools. There are not many studies particularly relating to PPPs, which have been done or evaluated PPPs in terms of their implications of what PPPs in education. So I will talk about what kind of studies I will comment in the emerging issues, but that is one thing have to be referred, that major literature relates to the broader discourse of privatization in that involves private schooling. So that are the studies. So there are lots of studies which have actually asked for the favor for vouchers on the grounds of serving poor, increasing competition and efficiency. And similarly, actually a very study done by Claire Narona and Prachi Shivastava in Delhi regarding the 25% reservation. And what they found, that this 25% seat reservation is actually not reaching to the people who actually deserve. It was actually used by the more advantaged households. So they found that is something very interesting. And similarly, a study like this was done by Jha in Bangalore, where she looked at, and within that clause, it also says it's a free education and students are not allowed to charge any other sort of fees. In terms of, there would be lots of entitlements which would be given, but they would be free of cost. Like you can say books, stationery, they would be provided free to this category. But when they actually did a study, they found that students were still getting charged for smart classrooms, and it was amounting to almost 10,000 towards capital account. So they were actually paying fees. There was nothing called free education in that. So that these are also some of the malpractices which are actually prevalent in the system. And then there is a study by Akansha Balsera. She tracked out ActionAid work. So she actually traced out the work of ActionAid, which actually it's very interesting, where they have eventually realized that they can't really substitute the state and they can't reach marginalized people in the way state reaches to them. So it's very interesting, and it says state is not substitutable, and neither PPPs nor NGOs can replace state work as the main bearer to the right to education. So this is, and then they studied private schools. These are low fee private schools. Again, it was very initial studies which worked on low fee private schools. So it's very interesting, which they found that as in the data also, that poor don't access private schooling. They are still dependent on government education. And similarly, now we'll come to the third aspect, that's the final one. So that's the quality, which is also a very contested issue. And within quality, there are many studies which relate to school facilities, teacher activity, attendance, and learning levels. And again, in this, major part of literature comes for comparison between public and private schools. So I'm skipping this. Again, Tilak has also raised, these are the PPP literature. So I will just talk about Mukhopadhyay, which was an anthropology study which was done on PPPs. It was done in DIET actually. So it was very interesting the way he has narrated how the work of teacher actually changes and how the private sector view education. So he raises very fundamental questions. He says that those groups who work actually replicate managerial practices and entrepreneurial governance in PPPs in education and completely ignore the role of the government in providing equitable. And they view education as a linear function, which is actually not. So, and they actually just import the processes which we actually find assembly line production in other sectors, and that is true. They do that only. Mm-hmm. So, and they replicate. And the people who, and what is interesting, the people who work in education in those areas have actually no idea about education. Mm-hmm. So we can say that should not be a fault, but a lot of people work in education with, I don't have much knowledge about, but since I'm also working. But the thing is, they don't even provide training as well. That is also questionable. They don't give those training to basic about, to enter into that area. So that is, and after that, how the, eventually he says that actually then the people who are working in the government sector and the private sector, there is a clash. And they are actually looked upon, so which is very suffocating. It is very discriminatory. So then it's a one study with Sara Bhanji. It's from US. It's a US study. She has looked at the Microsoft work. It's very interesting how they are actually they have dual treatments in different countries. So one country. Where they faced resistance because private sector is coming. So they were very cautious about their efforts. Say they provided free products. And in Jordan, where they were not actually, they were very welcoming they were welcomed. So they didn't actually provided subcontracted technologies. And they neither provided any free products to that. So that's interesting. It's much detailed. I'm just briefing out some. Now this is my study.
We have taken almost 45 minutes.
Okay. Yeah, I am finishing. Then I'm not telling about my study.
Yes. We want to hear it.
Okay.
It's very interesting.
Faster.
Okay. So the thing is, since there are not many studies on PPP, so my study, actually I looked at two types of modes of PPPs. One is Adarsh, that the fourth model which I have talked, where the government has given the full autonomy to the private sector to work. So one sort that was located in Punjab, And another is a school strengthening program, which is located in Haryana under the school nurture policy. But that is falls under the purview of CSR, which private sector has initiated, but they are routing through this program in that state government. So my question was that why private sector, because policy document tells what are the expectations of the government sector, but what about the private sector? Why they want to enter, but how do they view education and what are their interests in, and even if they will not disclose what their interests are, but what they think, how can they change, how can they improve, or what are this they take, how do they actually manage schools? Because two different models would give very two different stories of how they are actually managing the school. So it's not detailed, but I'm just sharing a preliminary findings what I have come up with. So a very important objective for the private sector to enter was sustainability. And sustainability not only in terms of actually sustaining their own existing programs, but in terms of sustaining financially as well. The motive of financial sustainability is very crucial. And it's very interesting since my work revolves around the foundation. It's a leading private education foundation. But the thing is, they have a huge corpus fund to take care of. So they can actually provide the best of services. But even with such funding, they still consider PPPs are important for sustaining it. We can't do that. So they do understand, but it's not, then it's very interesting. Government is saying that the private sector should rope in the resources, but private sector says they don't have it and they can't pump it. It's actually they want the resources from the government to sustain mm-hmm. their programs. Mm-hmm. So it's actually very contradictory. So, and then PPP is also one of a mode which an interesting theme is that they very specifically look into the modes of PPP. So what kind of arrangement is there between public and the private sector in that mode? So if that mode does not give them flexibility to operate, the private sector would never enter. So in this case also, they have made the conditions in such a way they can dictate terms in terms of how would they govern. And they say that it's actually not easy for them to make a set processes for one program and then create another set of processes. They have to align with everything. So when and second, relating to teachers, they don't pay as much as what the government teachers are getting paid. So that sort of flexibility is very much needed to them. So it's very interesting, and there are dual process of implementation. So within those modes, there are different ways actually they are managing. So I will stop this thing here. But some of the emerging issues, I will just say what has come up. First of all, there is an inaccurate PPP database. PPP database is actually collected by Directorate of Economic Affairs in India. But they collect information on PPPs only when the project is above the 5 crore rupees. So they don't collect information. So there is a lot of discrepancy in that.
50 million.
So and they also account for that PPPs which are actually have completed the stage of request for proposal, that is RFP step. After that step only they actually account for PPPs. So that is one thing, and within that you will find discrepancies in the policy documents which are talking about school education. They list some other number for PPPs and directorate tells other numbers. So that there is also one. And these are new and not studied, and there's a prominence of grey literature in terms of these are actually sponsored literature. So I will just
we will need to move on. I think we can get back to some of these in the discussion. Thank you.